Good morning. We gather in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please join in our scripture sentences, the call to worship from John chapter 10. My sheep hear my voice, says the Lord.
I know them, and they follow me.
And I give them eternal life. Would those who are able stand as we sing number 12, our hymn of praise, praise him, praise him. Bow with me as we pray. Father, we do gather this morning praising the name of your Son, Jesus, who is like a shepherd. Indeed, he is the good shepherd who laid down his life for the sheep, and he is the fulfillment of every prophet, priest, and king of the past. He is the one who tells us the truth. He is our prophet. He is the one who brings you into our lives. He is our priest, and he is the one who defeats our enemies. He is our king. And we thank you that by having him in our lives, we are safe, for he has overcome the world, over the world victorious. And so we know that in his care, we are safe. And we gather as those who are trusting and resting our lives in what he accomplished for us in bearing our sorrows and taking our sins upon himself and defeating them in his life, death, burial, and resurrection. For we gather this morning once more in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Take a moment to greet the people around you, and then you may be seated. Well, again, good morning and welcome to worship. Want to welcome those who are joining us online by Facebook Live. We're glad that you're with us in worship today, and we welcome those who are here with us this morning visiting. I see we got the Florida contingent right here, and Royal Wortman with us and her family, and so we welcome them with us this morning, especially, and others who may be visiting with us today. As we look at our announcements this morning, there is a quick congregational meeting right after this. Only took 13 minutes after the 8 o'clock service, so that's a good sign. So please stay after and be a part of this service as you'll be presented a PowerPoint presentation showing the damage that has been done to the roof and the plan that is being put forward to fix that. Other announcements, the highlight, we are, the Women's Guild is making potato salad for the fall, or for the Vandenberg County Fair, rather. And also, you can be a part of making that. They're looking for volunteers. That's a way you can give to the church. But also, they're taking orders. If you'd like pint or quart or more, you can call the church office and leave your order by Monday, July 19th. Also, do want to mention that next Sunday, I will be out of the office or away. I'll actually be leaving Friday and be gone through Tuesday evening. And the Reverend Paul Seberg will be filling in, and he was at the 8 o'clock service. I mentioned at that 8 o'clock service that Paul and Allison have put money down, and they're moving to Minnesota to be near their children. And so that will be in September. So this may be one of the last time he fills in. I don't know. So we want to pray for them as they're going up there, right as it's about to start getting cold, right at September. And I know Paul has a lot of mixed feelings about it, but do be praying for Paul and Allison. Any other announcements I should highlight? So go to prayer today. We have a joy to celebrate, and that is Sylvia Gross. While she had a leg fracture and had to go into the hospital to have surgery, John again reported this morning that she's recovering quite nicely for a person who's 95 years old who went through that trauma of breaking it right above her knee. And so be praying for her and for Don. I was able to visit with them in the hospital, and their son Kirby came in and has been with them as well. Kathy Day is out of the hospital. She has a heart monitor on, and she'll be wearing that for a week. She's under the care of a cardiologist, and then they'll be making decisions about what needs to be done for that. So do pray for Kathy Day, but that's a blessing that she's out of the hospital. Do be praying for the family of Brenda Krieg. This is a classmate of Eldon Scott's. She passed away Monday, July 12th. And then also be praying for Charles Decker and his family. This is Becky Millett's cousin's grandson, who is on hospice care, and she shared a link to the place where he's staying, and it's really a wonderful place and a real expression of love being shown to him and his family. So we praise God for that care that he's receiving right now. But he's in the end of life, just 12 years old. So definitely want to be praying for that family. Any other joys or concerns to share?
Thank everybody for praying for my husband, Don. His blood pressure, 188/94, is now normal.
Now normal, and he was able to fix it with medicine, and that was the problem. So, yeah, he went in and didn't know if it was heart problem going on, and it wasn't a heart attack, but it was blood pressure related. So we praise God for that. Well, fantastic. Yeah, that's a great blessing. Brad's mother's Brenda Wilner's 80th birthday today. Brenda Wilner, Brad Wilner's mother. Any other joys today or concerns? We Would you bow with me as we pray this morning? Oh God, again, we see you as the one who sent Jesus into the world. For John says, and Jesus speaking in John's gospel, that you so loved the world. And in John's gospel, the world is not a positive thing. It's in John's gospel that he comes into the world and the world doesn't receive him. And you call us to be in the world, but not of the world in John's gospel. And yet that world, as it's described in John's gospel, is the world that you sent your son into this world to redeem, because you love this world in its sinfulness. So that Paul will say that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we thank you, Father, that you sent us the true shepherd to come and show us the way to live into your truth and to guide us on the path of righteousness for your name's sake, to be that priest who would offer up himself so that we could feed on his flesh and drink of his blood to receive his sacrificial death, and that he would anoint us with oil and set a table before us in the midst of our enemies, the enemy sin, death, and the devil. And he came as the true priest who brought us into fellowship with you and feeds our souls in the relationship with you that we have. And he is our true king who walks with us through the valley of the shadow of death and, in fact, has defeated the last enemy, death. And as our king has brought security and peace to our lives in the midst of this world that still knows death, still knows these things, we can walk in this world with peace and with a sense of security and comfort. And we pray right now for these families that are dealing with this reality. We pray for the family of Brenda Krieg. We pray for Charles and for his family, that these who are dealing right now with this very real reality of what we experience in this world would experience once more that assurance that we have been given the true shepherd of the sheep, that you have raised him from the dead, and you have shown us that we are safe in his care, that he is over the world victorious, and we can know that we're secure, and we pray for that security to be experienced by these that are walking through this dark valley at this very time. We thank you that it's through him that we recognize how valuable and how loved we are by you, and how much you care about us, and how much each one of us as individuals is important to you. And we celebrate today with Brenda her 80th birthday, and of your love for her, and of your watching over her at this time. And we pray that this day would be a blessed day. We thank you, God, that it's through him that we live in a culture that has been shaped by so many of the teachings that he gave us through the apostles, interpreting who he is and interpreting the Old Testament. And indeed, we see such things as even the natural order of the universe and of the understanding of science is coming from this knowledge through him. And so we thank you as the ultimate source of the technology that has brought about this surgery for Sylvia Gross, that is working in this heart monitor for Kathy Day, and that is in that medicine that's being used to bless Don Schneider right now, oh God. And we thank you that you are using our efforts, that even as in our story today, the disciples will bring their bread and their fish, and you take it and multiply it and use them to feed the people. So you've used these doctors, these scientists, these people who have developed these techniques to bless the physical bodies of these members of our congregation, and indeed the members of our community, this whole community being blessed through their efforts. And we thank you, God, for what you're doing through all those who serve in some kind of capacity, reflecting the true shepherd, and that they're serving the people made in your image, whether it be the governmental leaders, whether it be those at work in the health professions, those who are first responders, those who are involved in the military, those who are serving through their work and through the products that they develop, through the companies that they have organized and brought into being to serve us and to bring forth so many of the great blessings that we've known in this land. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to work together and to realize more fully what it means to be made in your image and to be made to love one another, and that the logic of this universe is love, and the more that we live into that love and love one another, the more we'll experience your blessing. We pray, Lord, for the world around us that is still a place where so much is not right. And we can see that, as we'll read today, that so many live as sheep without a shepherd, as Jesus will say, that they wander aimlessly trying to figure out how to do things. And so many of those who are called to be shepherds, who have been given authority and power, just like the shepherds of the Old Testament abuse that power and use it for their own self-aggrandizement and expanding of their own riches and power and luxury. And we pray, God, that you would help us to speak the truth in love to our world, to call those who have been given these things to see it as an opportunity to be a blessing, that we're blessed in order to be a blessing, and we're given authority in order to use it and to bless those who are made in your image, that each person is valuable to you and loved by you. Thank you for those who are visiting with us today. We especially thank you for these who came all the way from Florida and are with us today. And we pray that you would bless their time here and their travels back and keep them safe. We pray all these things, O Lord, in unity with the great shepherd of the sheep, our prophet, priest, and king, Jesus Christ. And through our priest, Jesus, we pray to you, praying once more the prayer that he taught us to say as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
His heart.
Amen. What a blessing it is to know that God is that for us. He is the one that raises us up, and we come to know him as that one through his son Jesus, the good shepherd, who comes and embodies that for us in spite of the fact that we're not worthy of it, that we all like sheep have gone astray, that we've all sinned and fallen short of the righteousness of God. While we were yet sinners, he sent Christ to lift us up and to carry us as the good shepherd does. And we thank him for that. It's in response to this amazing grace of God and his love for us that we present our gifts this morning, the gifts that we received at the door, those that have come in during the week in the mail, and those that have been given online. With those who are able to stand us together, we thank God for his great blessings to us. We thank you, Father, that we've come to know that you are our Father and that this is your world, and that you're the author of the abundance that we see that is the potential of this world all around us with the rains and the sun, which have brought forth this growth of the corn, the beans, the gardens that we've been growing, the flowers around us. And we see the richness of your blessing towards us. And we thank you that when we've strayed from the way, and we've experienced judgment from living out of tune with you and out of tune with your purpose, that you did not abandon us, but you had compassion on the straying sheep, and you sent us the shepherd to bring us back to yourself, that we might know and experience the blessing by walking in the path of righteousness for your name's sake. It's for the knowledge of this one who is our true prophet, priest, and king, Jesus Christ, that we dedicate these gifts today in his holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture readings today have to do with the theme of the shepherd, and especially of leaders being those who are called to shepherd the people. In the Old Testament, there were three types of leaders. There were prophets. They spoke God's message, God's word. There were priests. They brought people into relationship with God by offering up the sacrifices and reconciling them to God. And then there were kings whose special job was to deliver them from their enemies while also being those who were leading. In Jeremiah, he's going to be speaking specifically to the kings, and he's going to be pronouncing judgment on them because instead of leading the sheep, they've acted self-centeredly, selfishly. They have been false kings, just like they're false prophets, false priests. But he's going to promise that God's going to raise up a true shepherd, a true prophet, a true priest, a true king from the house of David. Then our gospel lesson, Jesus is going to have compassion on the people because they're like sheep without a shepherd. And then he'll teach them. And then he's going to have them lie down in the green pasture, so to speak. And he's going to feed them. It's going to be the feeding of the 5,000. But if you notice, Mark emphasizes it's in the green grass that he has them sit down, showing that he is the fulfillment of the promise that God will give us a true shepherd. Would you bow with me as we prepare to hear God's word? Father, we thank you for your word today, that it is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. It is a sure and certain word in a world where there's a lot of confusion about what is the way to go, that you've come as the shepherd, especially in your son, Jesus Christ, to lead us in the right paths, that we might know your blessing. And so we pray, Lord, that you would help us to receive him who is watching over us right now and using this very exercise of reading and hearing and proclaiming the word to lead us and guide us into truth. For we ask it in his holy name. Amen. Reading from Jeremiah 23, "Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says to the shepherds who tend my people. Because you have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not bestowed care on them, I will bestow punishment on you for the evil you have done, declares the Lord. I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and will bring them back to their pasture where they will be fruitful and increase in number. I will place shepherds over them who will tend them, and they will no longer be afraid or terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up to David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness. Here ends the Old Testament lesson. And now we read from Mark's Gospel, chapter 6, the familiar story of the feeding of the 5,000, where Jesus shows himself to be the true shepherd who cares for the flock. Hear now the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. By this time it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it's already very late. Send the people away so they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered, "You give them something to eat." They said to him, "That would take 8 months of a man's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" "How many loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to set before the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of the men who had eaten was 5,000. Here ends the gospel lesson. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Invite the children present to come forward for our children's message. Good morning. You all look great this morning. You're welcome. The title of our story today is When Sheep Get Lost. See the sheep there, the picture of the sheep in the book? And the Bible verse is Psalm 119. The guy who wrote the psalm said, "I have strayed like a lost sheep." Of course, he's talking about the human situation. We get off the path. Here's the story. Mr. Keck was a rancher. He had many sheep. When they were eating grass, they behaved very well. But if one of them walked away from the place they were eating, they all wanted to walk away. Once, one of the sheep saw a hole in the fence and went through. So did the next sheep and the next one, until all the sheep had gone through the hole. Fluffy, a particularly frisky lamb, went through the hole too. When the neighbor's dog started barking, the sheep became afraid. They tried to find the hole in the fence, but they forgot where it was. They ran all over the field. One sheep broke a leg. One got caught in some bushes and couldn't get loose. Fluffy jumped over some tall grass and landed in a mud puddle. He was a very scared little lamb by the time Mr. Keck found him. God says that we often wander off just like sheep. Sheep don't have much sense about what's right, and we don't either. We do so many things we shouldn't do. We fight, we tell lies, we don't obey our parents, and we don't do the things God wants us to do. And all of this the Bible calls sin. What can we do about sin? We can tell God about it and ask him to forgive us and take us back. We can tell God about our sins when we say with the Bible verse, "I have strayed like a little lost sheep." And you know why we know God forgives us? Because he sent us the shepherd who laid down his life for us to die for our sins and to save us and to bring us back to God, Jesus. And so we know that we're forgiven when we say, "Lord, I'm a sinner. I get off the path all the time. I got this tendency to do it." And he says, "I forgive you. I've sent Jesus to be your Savior." Let's thank him for that. Lord, we have to say it's true. We're sinners. Paul was right. All we like sheep have gone astray. None of us is righteous. No, not one. But we thank you that while we were still sinners, you sent us the great shepherd of the sheep, Jesus. And through him, we know we have forgiveness of sins and that he'll guide us, if we'll let him, in the right paths for your name's sake. We receive this gift in his holy name. Amen. Thank you guys so much. Invite those who are able to stand as we sing number 89, "Jesus, the Very Thought of Thee." Remain standing as we affirm what we believe about Jesus caring for us, even now as he's ascended to the Father. We'll be doing so in the words printed in your bulletin from the book of Romans, chapter 8. Christians, what do we believe? We believe that Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Thank you. You may be seated. Our preaching text is the second half of verse 34 from the gospel lesson. Speaking of Jesus, Mark writes, "He had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd." Would you bow with me as we pray this morning? Father, we do ask once more that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer, for we ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Whenever I hear that verse, that he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd, I can't help but think about God's compassion on the people of Nineveh in the time of Jonah. Something that really shocked Jonah, because at the end of the story, God says, "I have compassion on them because they don't know their left hand from their right hand." He's saying they're so off the path, they're so out of touch with reality, this group of people, that they have gotten so out of the way that they don't even know their left hand from their right hand. And why is it that Jonah didn't want to go there? And why is it that God says to Jonah, "These people are completely lost touch with reality, and I have compassion on them"? Well, as I studied again the history of this people who made up Nineveh, Nineveh was the leading city of the Assyrians. These are some of the things I found. This is from the Baker Encyclopedia of the Bible, speaking of the Assyrian, of Assyria. "An ancient empire considered the symbol of terror and tyranny in the Near East. For more than three centuries, the Assyrians, 300 years, they were considered the symbol of terror. That is, that they would terrorize the people they subjected by doing things like skinning them alive, beheading them, and then stacking up heads on poles. And they would keep people subjugated by doing these very violent things to them." This is from the Dictionary of Old Testament historical books. "The most distinctive characteristic of the Assyrians was their attitude about war. For the Assyrians, war was a way of life." I think of the Greeks, it was the Spartans. For them, it was war was a way of life. And you know, I think about the Spartans, the way they would train their people to be so warlike is that they would force the boys to go live in these communal groups, and then they would not give them enough to eat so that they would be forced to learn to steal. But whenever they would steal and they got caught, they would be subjected to a extremely brutal and severe beating. And so they were in this catch-22. They were being taught to steal, but being taught to steal without being caught. And they lived in this very brutal and violent environment where they were taught to fight each other and to do all kinds of brutal things to one another. And in the same way, this was the Assyrians. It goes on to say, "From the monarch down to the lowest peasant, they were molded along military lines." Now, this is very different than their near neighbor, the Babylonians. For the Babylonians, war was a necessity of survival, but not a subject to dwell on. This shows you that even among the pagans, there could be levels of being disconnected from reality. The Babylonians saw, well, hey, war isn't what life is all about. While the Assyrians constantly boast in their inscriptions about their military accomplishments, the Babylonians rarely mention them, and instead describe in detail their religious and building activities. They got into other things like their religion and the things that they built. And one of the things we got to see when we were in Germany in Berlin was the great gate from Babylon that Nebuchadnezzar had built. And it's an amazing feat of what he built. And the Germans brought that back before World War I. Again, it goes on to say, "Since the Assyrians," these people of Nineveh that Jonah was sent to, "since they devoted the majority of their time and energy to war and building, they had little opportunity to develop themselves culturally." That is, they had gotten so off on this tangent about violence and violence is the way to live in the world, that they were truncated people and they failed to realize all the potential that God had put in them as human beings. This is from the Westminster Bible Dictionary. "The track of an Assyrian army was marked by carnage, ruin, and desolation. The capital of the country," that's Nineveh, "was denominated the Bloody City." Well, that's actually from Nahum chapter 3. Listen to what Nahum says in chapter 3. "Woe to the city of blood, full of lies, full of plunder, never without victims, the crack of whips, the clatter of wheels, galloping horses and jolting chariots, charging cavalry, flashing swords and glittering spears, many casualties, piles of dead, bodies without number, people stumbling over corpses. That's Nahum chapter 3. Now you wonder why Jonah didn't want to go there. Would you want to go there? No wonder Jonah, at the end of going and preaching, he went up on a hill and said, I can't wait to see them get what's coming to them. And of course, while he was up there waiting, he recognized that God wasn't going to bring what was coming to them because they repented and they turned to God. And that's when God causes this plant to grow over Jonah and give him shade. And then he causes a worm to kill the plant. And Jonah gets upset because of the death of that plant. And God says to him, you're upset about the death of this plant. Why can't I be concerned about these human beings who don't know their right hand from their left hand? They've become so disconnected from reality, Jonah. They've become so disconnected from the way to live that they have lived in this way that's so wrong because they are living in a way that's futile. It reminds me of Paul's description of humankind in Romans chapter 1. What does he say in Romans chapter 1, verse 21? Although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile. Hear that? That's what he was talking about the Ninevites. Their thinking had become futile. Their foolish hearts were darkened. They were darkened. They did foolish things. And then it goes on to say how disconnected their society had become. He goes on in verse 26, because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. The idea is they've become so disconnected from God that they no longer knew what maleness was for or femaleness was for. They had become futile in their thinking. They no longer understood what human sexuality is all about, that we were intended by God for the relationship of a man and a woman in lifelong marriage. And it's a sign of a society like Nineveh that has gone astray, that like a sheep has gone astray from the idea of God as creator and that we're on this earth and that the things we find about ourselves are here on purpose, that God is the one who made us male and female, that they've lost sight of how to live in the world. And it's in the midst of this that Jesus is looking out at these sheep and he has compassion on them, just like the God of the Old Testament had compassion on the Ninevites, because we all like sheep have gone astray. And he sees them and he says, these are like sheep without a shepherd. They have no one to come and to lead them in the right path. And so what does it say immediately after he has compassion on them? It says, so right away he began teaching them many things. The first thing Jesus does is he shows himself to be the true prophet. Because what does a prophet do? The prophet tells you what God's will is and what God's purpose is for you. And he's seeking to, as the Psalm 23 will say about the true shepherd, to lead them down the right path for his name's sake, to lead them in paths of righteousness. In fact, what does Jeremiah say? His name is going to be the Lord our righteousness. Of course, he's going to become, we'll talk about him being our priest, and he's going to give us the righteousness of God, but he's also the one who leads us into the right way of living in the world. It's not a way marked by the violence and self-centeredness and dog-eat-doggedness of the Ninevites, and it's not in this sexual license and the throwing off of the norm of maleness and femaleness of the described in Romans 1, but it's submitting yourself to the yoke, Jesus said. Take my yoke upon you, learn of me, and let me guide your life. Let me direct your life. One of the things we're blessed with is that we've lived in a culture that for 2,000 years has been influenced by this true prophet who came into the world. You go anywhere around Evansville, of course, you'll see a church almost on every corner. And for 2,000 years, all throughout Western society, there have been churches. Now, the influence of the church has been mixed. Obviously, not everyone has surrendered to the teaching of Jesus. The church has often been corrupt and gone the wrong way. And yet for 2,000 years, the teachings of of Jesus have been read from lecterns and pulpits, and people have been shaped by it, and it has brought forth, we can now look back and say what the Bible says is true. To the degree that you live into this way, it leads to a life of blessing. It leads to a life of prosperity. It leads to a bringing out of the world the potential that God has placed in the world. And we're living in an American culture that is blessed to have received that, in spite of the fact that there is a mixed history in our country and that there are those things that have been done wrongly and have caused hardship and pain to people. And of course, most notably, we've been talking a lot about the sad history of slavery. But as I mentioned, slavery is the norm in history, and it was a unique thing in Western history that it broke with slavery. In fact, it's still the norm today. Do you know that in China today, there are 30 million men who have no prospect of finding a wife? And do you know why they have no prospect of finding a wife? Because China had a one-child policy, and by having that one-child policy, they incentivized people to abort the girls and keep the boys because they could do the work that they needed around the farm. What did that mean? That meant no girls. 30 million men have no potential to find a Chinese spouse. So you know what the Chinese are doing right now? They're turning a blind eye to a slave market whereby people who are seeking to escape the tyranny and the horror of North Korea, they're crossing the border trying to find safety only to find themselves enslaved for these men who don't have any spouses. And that kind of slavery is just one example of the slavery that's happening all over the world today. But it was in a culture that was under the influence of the Christ that you had tracts that were being promoted during the time of the abolitionists. You can go back and look at the old woodcut tracts, and there's a person on that track, and he's got chains on him, and underneath it says, "Am I not a fellow man and a brother?" And where do those words come from? They come from the Apostle Paul. That's what Apostle Paul said to Philemon. He said, "I want you to receive your slave back, Onesimus, as a fellow man and as a brother." And we see that through the course of this long history of being under the influence of the prophet Jesus. Now, again, one of the interesting things that's going on here is not only is Mark showing that Jesus is the true prophet, who during the time in his life as he walked on the earth, he was giving them the words of God, but he's also speaking to us who don't have the advantage of having Jesus walking among us in that way. In fact, the people he was writing to, they were living at that time. And so Mark does something very specific here to show us where we can find the true teaching to guide our lives. It's in this place that only one time in the whole of his gospel that he refers to the disciples as the apostles. If you notice verse 11, the apostles gathered. And what were they gathering from? They were gathering from having just been sent out to preach and teach in his name and to drive the devil out of people's lives. And what Mark is showing us here is that Jesus has authorized these people to be his authorized representatives. To be an apostle is to be someone sent from somebody in their name. And he's saying, though you don't walk on this earth with Jesus as he was in his body, he has authorized a way for us to be led by him. In fact, that's why when Jesus has them all gather and sit down, he looks at the apostles and he says, "You feed them." And it's reminiscent of what Jesus said to Peter after he reinstates Peter. Remember, after Peter had denied Jesus, and he comes to Jesus, and Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me?" And he says, "You know, I love you, Lord." And what does Jesus say? "Feed my sheep." "Do you love me? Feed my lambs." "Do you love me? Feed my sheep." It's another way of saying that it's through the apostles that Jesus has ordained the way in which he's going to be the shepherd for us while he's not walking on this earth. And so it is that we don't have Jesus any other way but through the apostles. Because Jesus never wrote anything down. You can't get to Jesus around the apostles. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are authorized apostolic teaching about what Jesus said and did. And so you can't pit the apostles against Jesus and say, "Well, I'm not really going to follow Paul. I'm just going to follow Jesus." Well, you can't do that. You can't get around the apostles. In fact, Jesus said to the apostles, "Whoever receives you receives me." And he was basically saying, this is the way you're going to have me in my life. I'm choosing to work through these people. They're going to feed you. And of course, how do they feed us? Well, they feed us through the apostolic teaching. Remember when it talks about the early church and it gives the picture of the ideal church situation? This is Acts chapter 2. After they come to faith, it says four things about that early church that marked them out, the ideal church situation. Number one, they continued in the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and prayer. But what marks a church is what we say in the Nicene Creed. I believe in the one holy universal Christian and apostolic church. And to be a church of Jesus Christ is to receive the apostolic teaching in the New Testament as Jesus Christ himself leading us down the right path, leading us down the path that will lead to human flourishing. And what we find in the apostolic witness in the New Testament is a reception of the Old Testament being interpreted in and through the lens of Jesus, but fully being received through the teaching about Jesus. And so as Christians, we accept the whole Bible, the Old Testament interpreted through the lens of Jesus in the New Testament and the apostolic witness and the New Testament as our authority to guide our lives. And so we say in our church and our founding document that we look to the Bible as the infallible guide for faith and life, or you might say belief and behavior, doctrine and duty. We turn to the Bible because there we find that the true prophet, Jesus Christ, is leading us down those right paths for his namesake. And, you know, that has, again, like I said, the influence of the Bible on Western society is undeniable in the way it's shaped the way we think. In fact, I've mentioned before that Alfred North Whitehead, a famous philosopher of religion, said the very reason that science took off in Western cultures, unlike any other place, is because of the Christian idea that the created order is separate from God. It's not pantheism where everything is God, and that it's not it's an object outside of ourselves, and it operates according to reliable laws. And it's out of that worldview shaped by the Bible that we enjoy all of these great gifts of modern science. And we can look at all kinds of things that come out of this. The idea that before Christ, there was no such thing as a hospital, let alone a hospice, let alone the kind of hospices that we have today that care for the sick and the needy and the hurting, that the individual was made in the image of God and of lasting value before God, and that we were all created by God as equal. You know, as we live today, we have to keep aware always that there's constantly the temptation of human beings to go off track, right? As we said in our children's sermon, prone to wander, we sing in the hymn, Lord, I feel it. We all, like sheep, are prone to go astray. And we have to, as Christians, we need to be looking at the world with a critical eye and say, is this in line with my rule of faith? When someone becomes a council member, we ask, do you look to the Bible of the Old and New Testaments as your rule of faith? And do you promise to exercise your office in accordance with your rule? And as we look at our culture today, I've been disturbed myself to see some of the trends going on in the culture, not just about the abandonment of the idea of male and female, but also the abandonment of the idea that our culture is based in this understanding that human beings are both made by God and therefore have great capacity to do good things, but also sinners and have a great capacity to do evil. One of the things I really wanted to understand and know better is this reality that's you hear in the news all the time, critical race theory. One of the things I was blessed in my education, I took a course in theological research methods, and we learned a way of criticizing theories and things that was taught by Mortimer Adler. Mortimer Adler was a philosopher from the University of Chicago. He did the Great Books of the Western World, the Great Ideas Program, various things. And he wrote a book called How to Read a Book, which seems very strange. It was a very popular book. But in there, he talks about how to really analyze various viewpoints and then to criticize them fairly. And he said, first of all, before you can say that you disagree with something, you have to be able to say you understand. And in order for you to be able to understand, you need to put aside your assumptions, adopt the assumptions of the people that you're trying to understand, and then see what they're saying through their lens. And then having done that, having first been able to say that you understand, then you're at a place that you can say that you disagree. And here are the four things you need to do in order to disagree fairly and rightly. You either need to show where they're uninformed, misinformed, illogical, or incomplete. And if you can show one of those four things, then you are not just sharing opinion, he said. You're actually seeking to advance knowledge. Well, in trying to understand this critical race theory, I searched for what is the best book explaining what it's all about. And the book that comes is being mentioned all the time is Critical Race Theory, An Introduction, co-written by one of the movement's founders, a guy named Richard Delgado. And I've looked, and the library actually has it on order, so they recognize that this is an important book for our time. But I haven't been able to read it, so I want to be fair, but I've read it. I've heard enough from this book and from two other places. They say, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, let anything be established. And out of these three witnesses, there are things that concern me about the fact that people are being led down the wrong path. And what does it mean when you lead someone down the wrong path? It means you're a false prophet and that you're bringing false prophecy. And what is it being said? These are some quotes from this book, Critical Race Theory, An Introduction. This actually began in law schools. This is one of the foundational texts of this particular movement. The first thing it says, this is a quote, "Everything must change at once." That is, part of what critical race theory is saying is that we can't have incremental change in our country. What we need is a revolution. The things that we did in the past to help address the race problem, school busing or affirmative action, these things will never work. Because what's at the heart of the problem is that the system is bad. It is a systemic racism, and so we need to throw off the entire system and start over. Here's what the author says. Critical race theory questions the very foundations of the liberal order. The liberal order is America as we know it, Enlightenment thinking of, here's what it says, including equality theory, this is a direct quote from the book, legal reasoning, Enlightenment rationalism, and neutral principles of constitutional law. This idea that the judge is to act neutrally, he's not to favor any particular person, he or she is supposed to apply the law equally to all people, that we're all equal before the law. All these things should be questioned, and because it's rooted in the very system is rooted to advance whiteness, the system itself has to be overturned. Well, that's one witness. I just read yesterday that the Smithsonian took down its whiteness chart, but you can read the whiteness chart at Newsweek. Newsweek published this. And here's what the whiteness chart that was published by the Smithsonian Institute at the Museum of African American Studies said. These are things that have to do with whiteness. The value of the individual, the importance of the nuclear family, objective rational thinking, the Protestant work ethic, English common law, and the protection of private property. These are saying that these things are not things that developed because they fit reality, and that they came out of an understanding of reality that works, but that these were actually imposed upon reality to advance a particular race, that is, white people. And what we need to do is overthrow these things. And then the third witness, if you went early on when the Black Lives Matter movement began at the BLM website, it said that one of the goals of their movement was to overthrow the nuclear family. Which, what does that have to do anything with advancing one, the rights of one particular group of people or another? But it just shows you where they're coming from, and where they're coming from is something that was proven to be wrong. And that which has proven to be wrong is what we call Marxism, because Marxism is a Christian heresy. And I think I have a right to speak about this because it's based on a Christian idea. And that Christian idea is that the order of the universe and what makes the universe ultimately work is not sheer power and dominating the other. That was the problem of the Ninevites and of the Assyrians. They believed that they basically were Darwinists. They were basically social Darwinists. It's survival of the fittest, and we're gonna dominate and kill other people. And yet what we found even in our own country is that the more we approximate the kingdom of God, which is people taking the gifts they've been giving them and using them to serve each other in a society of peaceful interaction, the more that society is able to produce great things and to be blessed. And the communists, of course, the Marxists, Marx himself, when he said famously, from each according to his or her ability, to each according to his need or her need, he was reflecting this idea that the moral order of the universe really is love. But what they didn't get, and where they were wrong, and why it's a Christian heresy, is that the Bible is very clear through the apostles that this world will never be the kingdom of God. In fact, Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world." In fact, his authorized apostle Paul said, "Until the day you die, you're going to have an old man, an old woman, and you're going to have to fight that every day. And the purpose of government in this world is not to bring in utopia, But Paul says in Romans 13, it's to restrain evil because you're going to live in a world to the very end that is filled with evil possibilities within human beings. Again, it reminds me of what Winston Churchill said about democracy. He said, many forms of government have been tried and will be tried in this world of sin and woe. Think about that. That really shows the influence of the church. That it's out of this Western culture where there's this awareness that we have this thing called original sin that this statesman would speak. And this is what he says. He said, no one pretends that democracy is perfect or all wise. Indeed, it has been said that democracy is the worst form of government, except for all those other forms that have been tried from time to time. And again, there's never been a time when you've given people all the power that the communists say that you have to have in order to overthrow a system and to rebuild it. Because that's basically what you have to have. That's what Marx said. You have to basically first give them all of this power to bring in the utopia. And once they brought it in, they'll let go of it. But Stalin didn't do that. Mao didn't do that. Castro didn't do that. Kim Jong-un didn't do that. And no one is going to do that because all are sinners. We're all sinners. And you're never going to bring utopia into this world. And you're never going to bring in the kingdom of God because the kingdom of God is a gift of God. And until then, we're just going to be living in this world. And the purpose of government is to restrain sin. And that's why the Western tradition is influenced by people like Lord Atkin, who said, power corrupts. And absolute power corrupts absolutely. Or the Frenchman Montesquieu, who said power checks power. And that you have to have a system whereby by big corporations and business people have to be checked because you can't trust them. They're sinners. And governments have to be checked because they're sinners. And you have to create whatever system you create as a system that it fits the way the reality is that has been defined for us by Jesus through his authorized apostles who say, in this world you will always be, yes, sinners and saints. And so as a great political theorist Christian, Reinhold Niebuhr said, democracy is possible because of man's ability for justice. We're not devils. We're not completely evil. But democracy is necessary because of a man's capacity for injustice. It's always going to be that ambiguous mix. And so I have to say that today as we're thinking about these things, that if these things are true, and I'm still learning about this theory, but again, everywhere I turn, what I hear from this theory is because this is systemic, because the very system is bad, we need this revolution to throw this system off, and we need to start over, and we need to get rid of things like individual rights, protection of private property, equality theory, neutral principles of constitutional law to bring in the day of utopia. In the midst of all that, it can be overwhelming. You know, as I study all this, it's overwhelming. But that brings us to the next thing about Jesus here. Not only is he showing himself to be the true prophet who leads us down the right paths, but as he has them sit down on the green grass to show him that he's the true shepherd, he takes the bread and he gives thanks over it. The very same thing he's going to do in Mark 14 at the Lord's Supper. And then he breaks the bread and he gives it to them. All the words are the exact same, and it's a way of saying this Jesus who is now feeding you bodily is going to feed you spiritually. He's going to be the true priest, not just the true prophet, the true priest. And by being the true priest, he's going to bring you close to God. He's going to bring at-one-ment with God. And this is the Christian secret in the midst of a world where we have to continue the fight all the time for the truth. How were the Christians able to defeat the Romans? You know, the Christians didn't become strong after the resurrection. After the resurrection, they were still hiding in their places. It was on the day of Pentecost when, because of what Jesus did in bringing us close to God, that their lives were filled with the power and reality of the Holy Spirit, that they were given an energy and a power that caused them to outlast the Romans. It took 3 centuries for them finally to outlast the Romans and for the Romans to fall. But the fact of the matter is the Romans didn't have the power and energy and reality that the church has. And so this is once more reminding us, we don't know exactly where the direction of the future is in our country. I don't know that. I don't know in our world. But I do know this. That Jesus Christ is still the true high priest, and he brings the reality of the Holy Spirit into our lives, and he is over the world victorious. And he said, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And as Paul would say, greater is he that is in you than the power that's at work in the world. You'll be able to endure in this world, even if it means that you might die, because you have an energy, a power, a reality that is energizing your life. But not only that, as he was feeding them, that bread. It was symbolizing what else he accomplished on the cross. Because not only is Jesus our true prophet who brings us the true way of living life, the true priest who brings God into our lives, he's the true king. And in the Old Testament, the primary role of the king was to defeat the enemies of the people. Think about the story of Saul and David. David shows, even when he was not yet king, that he had the true heart of a king. When he comes up to the battle lines of the Philistines and he sees Goliath threatening the people of God, and he is filled with indignation that this man is threatening the people of God, and he defeats Israel's enemies. And in that moment, he shows himself to be the true king. And by taking upon himself our enemy, which is sin, and how it separates us from God, and how it brings us under the tyranny of the devil. And as Hebrews says, that the way the devil tyrannizes us is through the threat of death. That by taking that all upon himself, Jesus has defeated our enemies. He's defeated our sin, he's defeated the devil, and he's defeated the last enemy, death. And so in Jesus, our true prophet, priest, and king, the great shepherd, we are free to live for him in this world. You know, faced in a world where people were living contrary to God's purposes, Martin Luther King, who himself was an ambiguous person, right, a sinner, but who spoke truth when he was writing from a Birmingham jail, his letter from a Birmingham jail, he appeals to the apostolic witness in the Bible. And he speaks from that witness to this Western culture of the United States and says, this is what you're doing. This segregation is wrong. And he uses that prophetic, pure prophetic teaching of Jesus to leverage against that which was wrong in this society. But he was asked one time, how are you able to do this? How are you able to take these kinds of risks? And he said, once you're no longer afraid of death, well, then you can do this. And you see what Jesus is saying to us today is like we sing in that song, God of grace, God of glory, give us wisdom, give us the ability to live for the facing of this hour. Well, if we know Jesus is our true prophet, priest, and king, then no matter how the society around us is going, we can stand for the truth against going down the wrong paths. And like Martin Luther King at that moment, we can speak from what Jesus is saying and saying, this is not going to lead down to the way of life and to the way of righteousness. This is going to let it lead instead down to the way of death. You know, in my own life, when I'm dealing with a struggle in my life and going through a hard time, the one thing that always helps me is just getting up the next day and going and doing what I need to do that day and being faithful in what I'm doing. And you know, in a very similar way, that's being told to us in this passage today, because not only is Mark saying to the people he's writing to that God has chosen to work through those apostles to be at work in you, but he's also saying to us that as those who are built upon those apostles, as Ephesians will say, being built up to be God's presence on the earth, he's looking at us through the story and he's saying there's a hungry world out there. In the world you live in today, the people are like sheep without a shepherd. And you who are built upon the apostles and the prophets, I'm calling you to feed them. You to feed the hungry heart. And so I don't really, you know, there's only so much I can do as a human being, but the one thing I can do is I can fulfill the calling on my life to share the word of God with people and to feed those hungry hearts that he will send our way with the truth of who God is in Jesus Christ, the one who shows us this is why you're made male and female, who shows us this is why you're meant to be. You are meant to act out of love, but you're a sinner, and so you need to always be constantly brought back to the truth. And he is the one who brings you to have the power of the Holy Spirit in your life, and he's the one who assures you whether you live or whether you die, you belong to the Lord. Would you bow with me as we pray? Father, we thank you for the gift of true prophecy and that we are assured that your apostles are true prophets, that they speak the words of Jesus to us. And through them, we receive the Old Testament as true prophecy. Thank you that you sent us the true priest who brings us back to yourself and that you fill us with your presence. And we have a power that will outlast any empire, any regime. And thank you, O God, that we have a king who has defeated our enemies, and so we know we are safe, and we can live our lives in boldness for you in our time. We receive all these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. With those who are able, stand as we sing our closing hymn, number 683, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. Thank you. perverse and foolish, oft I strayed. Wow, that's powerful, but that's the truth. But yet in love he sought me. And it's still amazing to think that God sought out those Ninevites. As evil as their culture was, as off the trail that they were, he loved them. And that tells us about God's attitude to the world around us. That the people in our world are not our enemies. The people who are trying to go, we might really feel you're trying to take us down the wrong path. But they're still not the enemies. They're the ones that Christ died for. No, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, spiritual wickedness in high places that would seek to undermine the life God intended. And so our job is to go out and to bring the straying sheep back to the one who is their true prophet, priest, and king, the great shepherd of the sheep, Jesus Christ. Again, I'm going to give the blessing, but if you're a member, please sit down, okay, and don't leave. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine down upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.